So hello everybody, what you're looking at here is my animation for BNA, Brand New Animals, cover title, and this is how I decided to animate it. So a lot of what you're going to see here is me just working on the project and me basically explaining it and maybe throwing in a couple of other things as the animation goes through. What I decided to do here is first I wanted to cut out all the red section, and by that I mean the main wall and Tanuki Girl, whose name I always forget, I don't know why. But I wanted to cut them out first and make them their own separate thing, and then I was gonna animate most of the background and a little bit of Tanuki Girl, which you'll see later on. I would focus primarily on trying to get the hair and trying to get the detailing just right. Well, who am I kidding about detailing? I'm trying to get the lines to match up with her hairstyle. And that's what I'm starting out here to do. And the main reason why I want to animate this image is because it's a very simple image to where simple animations make the whole thing look pretty good. By the way, anytime you see my mouse go off the screen for something, it's probably me just fiddling around with my music. Because, you know, that's basically the most important thing for any artist when they're working, because dead silence is kind of boring. So yeah, here you see me cutting it out, and I'm taking the main base image and I'm separating it from the back. Then there's two images right there. So now I have the red image and the blue image. With the red image, what I'm gonna decide to do is I'm gonna separate Tanuki and the wall and then create an animation based on them. And here I think I was just planning out what I want to do with the blue image and whether I should cut it out now or if I should focus more. And I'm like, yeah, there's a couple of these that I need to scrape out because the lines are too dark. And that's basically what I decided to do. So now we're in the red. And what I wanted to originally do was kind of have the Tanuki tail sort of do this whole full motion going from back to bottom. But later on, I decided against that. And I'll explain why when we get to that point in the blue image. But yeah, so here you just see me cutting out the shoes and stuff. And the main idea for the whole piece is I wanted the two characters to sort of be like standing against the wind, and the wind comes every now and then. It's not something consistent. One, it saves amount of time I need for the animation, but another is so that it also it creates this ability to be able to be looped, and that's one of the main things that I think is important for me, because especially with a lot of videos and stuff, when people want to use something, they want to loop it, and you don't necessarily want something that just goes one way and then you find something else in order to repeat it. It's better just to have something that repeats on itself or can be repeated by itself. So you see me cutting her out, and then I have to work on the wall. And the wall was pretty simple because there's other lines within it that could match up easily. However, the little edge corner that her knee blocks is a little tricky because, as you see, it's brighter on that one and none of the others have that brightness. So that was something I needed to tinker around a little bit more and sort of decide how I wanted that to look. And that's basically most of what you're gonna see for a little bit, is me just working on the wall. So I'll let this play out a little bit, and once something else new comes around, I'll talk about that just for a little bit. So here you're just seeing me properly cut the line down and just making it look sharp. That way it fits. And then I'm just checking to make sure she still fits there. think I start cutting out the tail at this point. Yeah. So again, there's me making an extra cut, and that was, again, primarily because I wanted to do this whole motion range, but that never comes about, but I still cut it out anyways, and I'm glad I did because it makes it feel a little bit more natural. So what I'm doing here is I'm cutting out the stump, and it helps so that there's always that point that's connected to her. Originally this was just going to be a small animation, and you see me adding a little bit more of the back end of the tail in so that it fortifies the base. This never really gets used too much, aside from just looking like it and showing that it's still connected to her. Again, this was back to the original idea of the tail just going these full motion ranges. But so next I have the interesting task of cutting out her hair. And I say interesting because what I originally wanted to do was also move the collars. And the thing is, the collars are so close to her neck that I would need to remove them, and even when I turn them into a mesh, it doesn't look right. You'll see that more when I get into the full animation, not just the cutout section. But yeah, it's didn't come out the way how I hoped, but the hair came out nice. So I'm gonna cut out the two main lobes of her hair on both sides and have those move along in the wind. And that's just me making a reference image so that I know where to put them later on. And make sure to give it a nice bit of space so that it can rotate without it looking weird and looks like it's part of the head. So now I need to rebuild the face from the part that I just took out. So I'm just gonna choose a color, and this is one of the reasons why I actually like this piece, is because the colors are very basic. I don't need to like have a very good grasp of drawing per se, like with a lot of things, because I don't really have a good drawing hand to say that. So I choose. So the colors are so simple enough that I can literally just take a brush and just make it up. A bit later I decide to keep to do like a sample texture because there is a bit of noise, and that way I'm not killing myself need to make a separate layer for each time I want to edit. I just decide to use the texturized version rather than making a new version and adding in the noise. It's more evident on the clothes and the backgrounds than it is on the characters themselves. See, there you see a little bit of me just adding in a bit of the noise on that top part, but everything else is just pretty simple enough, and I just want it to look good enough that I can hide the very noticeable brush strokes with the pieces that's going to be animated. There's the back lobe of the hair that's also going to be moving as well. I stretch it out a little bit so that it has room for rotations and stretching. By the way, this anime is really good. Right now, at the time of recording, there's only 6 episodes out. The next 6 are supposed to come out next month, I believe. Maybe a little bit later. But yeah, it's a really good show. I'm gonna save my full thoughts on it till after it's all finished, but yeah, it was a good show. Okay, so I duplicated the body there, and now I'm working on the clothes. Again, basic brush strokes. I just gotta make sure that it looks right and that the tail covers some of it. End up making her butt look a little bit flabby, but the tail covers most of that. Again, I don't have the best hand at drawing, so doing something simple like this was pretty great. And yeah, so here I'm just checking to make sure that everything looks good and making sure that I have all the assets that I need. And I believe at this point I realize, oh, I need to do the neck. So I go in and I'm like, okay, let's fix up this collar. I believe this is where I took the sample and I built it up. Yeah, I did. And that's because the collar is so tight that there is a bit of textural difference. So I built it up with using the previous texture from the first lobe and I made it up from there. Then I take the color of the neck because that's going to be hidden by the hair. And from there I just start building up the neck. And this is where I could have either gone two ways, and I probably should have gone with the second way if I really wanted to animate the collar, because with the collar still being attached to the neck, when I want to move the collar, it also ends up warping the neck as well. But that's something you realize in hindsight. So here you have me looking at the background, and what I believe I'm doing first is I'm cutting out the statue of Shiro, I believe his name was. And yeah, I keep confusing the back part of his cloak for part of the background because of the color similarities, but I figure that out soon enough. So I cut out Shiro first, that way I can build up a bit of the background behind him. So that way his body and animations could be done smoothly and all the background will still be there. The one thing I kind of wish I could have kept is the international welcome sign. And that's just something I couldn't have done, mainly because the way how they have it written is not something that you can inherently animate without having a really, really warped design for it. And that's something I don't necessarily know how to do. I would love to know how to do it, but I spent close to 3 days on this project, and by about the third day, by the second day, I was like, yeah, no, I'm keeping this super simple. I'm not going over the board like I thought I would have. Yeah. I'm really surprised, though, because Shiro's a lot more blocky and rigid, but I guess that's supposed to mimic his character. So he's very tough, strong, rigid, sharp, I guess. And so they replicated that with him. Yeah, and again, I keep trying to focus on little knacks, that way I can cut that out a little bit better. Yeah. By the way, the song that's going on right here, this is literally the one that carried me through most of this entire animation process. It's that good. So now I believe I decide I'm going to rebuild the tail. And at first I was like, oh, I'll use the brush strokes because it's one simple color. And then it's like, no, I need to clone stamp this because the noise and the texture of the image really actually does set up how the look is, which is a complete difference from the Tanuki girl, where you could easily just brush stroke her in, but for Shiro you really need to use the noise and the texture in order to get it to look right. And that little piece of his arm is something that I realized, like, I think towards the end of it all, that I need to cut out. So that's just going to be there for a little bit. And let's see, what am I heading to do? Oh no. Oh yeah. Because I was about to duplicate his body so that I could copy it. And then I'm like, oh wait, I need to cut out that middle part before I do that. Let's see, what do I decide to do next? Yeah, so I decide to cut out his cloak, and the interesting part about this is I decided to go for around midway and have it lock under his arm and have the part under his arm be a very stable area, which you'll see when we get into the actual animation and not just the asset retrieval. But I chose this part, I chose the height at which I cut it off because I could have done a little bit more, but then it's gonna make the rest of his body look weird when I warp it, and that's something that I had at the time of cutting it out. Just make sure that it looks good, and then I am now building up the legs. And this is why I have an extra file version of it. Also, you see me just using the brush right here. That's because since most of this will be covered by the cloak, I'm just gonna sort of merge the texturized version of him in with the brush strokes and then leave the cloak to cover up anything that looks awkward. And just a little bit more touch-ups. It's basically me just trying to figure out how far up I want the cloak to cover. And now here, I actually have to recreate the entirety of the back of his cloak, because his leg and his tail covers up a large portion of it. So I'll need to rebuild that up. And interesting note, the back portion is actually done with a gradient of sorts, because each section of that cloak has a different shade of light blue. So I believe I was just like, yeah, no, we're just gonna go with one version of light blue. But I kept that little bit of the tail end there, mainly so that I can go back and create this nice little trim so that it looks like it's a part of it, but in reality, everything had just been cut out. I think this was me cutting out the part from the original leg because I forgot to do that before. Yeah. Alright, and here we have me cutting out the tail. Tail was pretty easy since I had already done that before. I would just need to fix up that little back end area, and luckily the color and the texture between the cloak and the tail were exactly the same, so I just need to get rid of the line. So here's just me making sure that I have it right, realizing I should add a little bit more into the leg. And then on the main body, just stretching it down so that the cloak has a little bit of room to breathe. Alright, now we get into the fun part, the background. So, the background is one of the more complicated areas, because I was like, oh, should I try and replicate it, which is what I'm gonna try and do here, and sort of continue it, and then at some point I'm just like, yeah, no, recreating the entire background is not gonna do it, we're just gonna need to cover up the edges, and then let the figures cover up what we took out. Because as you'll see here, I first start out with, oh, let me rebuild the sign. And then as that goes through, I realize, yeah, that's not a good idea. I forget when I decide that. I think it's like after I do the first sign, I'm like, yeah, this isn't gonna work. Yeah, so at this point I realized, well, if I can't make the sign move because a lot of it's been taken out, why don't I just recreate the image of the sign, and that's going to lead to me just being like, yeah, I don't need to recreate everything, I could just take out and make it look like that. And since this sign takes up a large portion of where the cutout was, simply by replacing this, it looks a lot better. And so, again, I end up getting rid of the welcome, bienvenido, I forget what other language they had there, and I kind of wish I could have kept that. Maybe one day I'll figure out how to do that, but for right now I'm just like, I'm just gonna get that basic texture and I'm gonna make something that looks like it, and then keep that. Forget how long it takes me, because at first I'm like, okay, I'm gonna follow the pattern that's here and I'm gonna make a really nice looking texture, and somewhere in between there and what I end up with, it looks nothing like that. And that's also mainly because the blues being used here are actually both gradients. It's very slight, but the colors just would have not matched. And there you see me trying to figure out, huh, that's interesting, they're not matching. But yet they match up there. And the gradient used in this is really weird. And by really weird, I mean, even the basic color that I'm filling it up with now isn't the actual gradient color. Like, there's this very small, minuscule difference, but it's noticeable. And there's just me trying to figure it out, spread it out, and then at some point, I believe it's when I start recreating the rest of it, that I'm just like, yeah, no, we're gonna make a completely different one. And it's gonna happen soon, because I'm gonna realize, yeah, I need straight lines for this, and then I'm gonna be like, ugh, the colors aren't working. So at some point, it goes from this, I think it's 5-color image to 3 colors. And all of light blue, mind you. So funny story about this, I started this and somewhere along the way I lost which side of the lining I'm going to do, if I'm doing the outside lining or if I'm doing the inside lining. So it kind of makes me trying to replicate the pattern a little bit pointless, but it also is to keep it looking similar enough. And at this point it's like, wait, which side am I doing? And then I'm like, oh, I'm doing the inside. No worries. And I'm just trying to get these lines parallel enough so it looks straight, or like at least that it belongs there. I try my best to get that done, but to me personally, it doesn't look like it did. See, here is where I start realizing, wait a minute, which side am I doing? I think I'm doing the inside. The inside's blue. And I'm getting a little bit confused again. And here I am. I'm like, wait, no, I'm doing the outside? Okay, let me fix that. So I do that, and then I realize, oh, I need to include this little bit. So I try this again, and then it's like, yes! Then I realize there's another step there, so it ends up looking like a little weird thunderbolt. So there's the main image, and this is at least 2 to 3 colors, and then I'm like, yeah, no, I'm gonna make this 1 color. So now I'm filling in all the spaces in between, merging it up. Then I'm like, no, I'll keep the 2nd color so that it has a little bit of difference. Decide, well, how far do I want the 2nd color to go? Well, the 3rd color, I guess. It's like, I'll have it cover up the 2nd point, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have it be a transitional color, that way I know where I am when I'm animating this. So here I decided to start working on the cheetah, which I kind of not necessarily regret, but I think if I wanted to keep the entire thing simple, I probably shouldn't have done that. And I'll explain why as we go through this. So here's me isolating the picture, and next I am going to work on the logo, mainly because my idea is to get the cheetah sort of running, but the logo should always be there. So here I'm working on separating the arm, body, and legs. And so by doing that, I'll have assets that I can use in order to show that it's running. The front arm is actually pretty easy. And the second leg is just a reprint of the leg that you see there. It's the back leg that ends up giving me trouble. I mean the back arm. So there's just me making sure that the arm looks okay when I rotate it. Then I believe right after I start working on the body. If not, I start on the leg, let's see. So there's just me finishing up the background, making sure it looks nice. It was an interesting gradient, I'll say, because it's not inherently just purple to blue, but rather blue to purple. I'll cut that out. Alright, so here we work on the back arm, and this is where things get a little interesting, because at first I cut out the back of the arm. And then I'm like, okay, I could just overlay this with the arm, and then I realize, wait, the hand is not going to be right, so I need to redo the hand. And at first I was like, I could probably just mirror the hand and make it look right, and then it's like, no, that's not going to look right, it's just going to look like a mirrored hand. So I think I do a lot of this off camera, where I try figuring out how to get the arm to look right. And so essentially it led to me cutting out the hand and then cutting out the forearm and then redoing a lot of it, but keeping a lot of it the same, that way it doesn't look so drastic and not like my bad drawing skills get in the way. But that's most of what happened with the cheetah, and a lot of the extra work that comes in with it is more after all of this. So here I decide, okay, I'm also going to animate the sunglasses girl, and I'm going to take it out into a couple of layers. I'm going to have the ear and the hairs be their own separate layers that's going to move with their own wind, and I'm going to have the glasses do like that nice little tilt down. And that's most of what I work on right here. Not too much hard work. It's a lot of just cutting it out. Again, not much really to say here, it's just me getting the texture of the character's skin to match up and just making it look nice. At some point I start working more on the hair, since I can make it more believable that she has really long bangs than just a really long face, I guess. I think that was my thought process behind switching over to doing the hair instead. So here you sort of get an idea as to what I kind of want to do with it. And I believe I didn't notice that she has the blue little bit in her until right about then, and then I'm like, oh yeah, that needs to go away. No, I actually never realized how much time I actually spent on this character. I always thought it was something really quick that I did with her, but no, I did a lot with her. Interesting. And that's actually something that I find kind of funny. I worked a lot more on the backdrops than I did on the actual characters themselves. It's a little sad, but... So yeah, once again, I'm just testing it out. So, while this is going on, I think this might probably be the first video that goes up on my channel, and I guess maybe I should give a little bit of a statement. I want this channel to primarily be something where I create what I really want to make. A lot of the stuff that I edit and a lot of the stuff that I do is mainly for other people, and then sometimes I don't really want to do those projects, and so this channel I want to focus more on things that I want to do. Things that can't exactly do with other videos or with other channels, because a lot of stuff that I do is other people's work, in essence. I do a lot of conventions, and a lot of what I do there is I talk to independents, or I talk to other artists, or I talk to XYZ, and this channel, I wanted to do something different with that. I wanted to do stuff that I really like, stuff that I can be proud of and say, yeah, I did that. Because a lot of what I do is, yeah, it's for other people. I want to do something mainly for me, and that's kind of what I want to do with this. Even if it's like taking something that's like a different anime and redoing it into a new way, that's something that I want to do. I want to do stuff for me and my channel. Now, that doesn't mean I'm not going to still do cons on the other channels that I do, and I'm not going to help out the other channels. It's just this place is primarily for my content, and if anybody wants to work with me for my content, then they could. But yeah, I want this to be more my channel stuff. Yeah, this is what I want to do, and yeah. Even just taking stuff like animation, then I guess I haven't really figured out what I want to do with the channel just yet. There's a lot of things I want to do. I want to do games, I want to do anime, I want to do my own creative projects. So we'll see how the channel goes and see how it evolves over time, and yeah, we'll see what ends up happening. And yeah, that's all I could really think about for the channel right now. What you're seeing here, I guess, is just me working more in the background, stretching that out, and then at first I'm like, oh, I should make all this blue, and then I'm like, wait, no, the hair's here, so I end up picking up the, doing the hair. But here you also notice the different shadings that they have just in the background. Like, the top of this billboard is a completely different shade of blue than the bottom. And I sort of just don't realize that until a little bit closer toward the end. I'm like, yeah, that doesn't look good. I'll need to fix that. But yeah. Also, if you have managed to make it through this whole point in the video, if you have any suggestions as to what I could possibly do, then feel free to leave in the comments. And also, don't forget to like and subscribe if you managed to make it through this far. You might as well, I guess. And yeah, I think that should do it. And you just see me working a little bit more. This was a little bit of the harder part of this character because the colorations were just so different in this part of the head that I needed to selectively choose which parts I want to sample from. And a little tricky. I eventually got the hang of it. I made it look as best as I could, but yeah, it was a little tricky getting it done. So unlike the top part of the hair, this part was pretty easy. I decided to go against keeping the shoulder as wide as it was, because that just started looking really weird to me. Plus, the hair is going to cover a lot of it, so. taking a look here now, and I'm trying to decide what's the next thing that I want to do. The cola billboard is an interesting one, because at first I thought, hey, why don't I have the whole thing just animate where she's drinking the cola and the waves come up, and then I'm like, yeah, no, I'm doing that with one. I already see how much work and trouble that's gonna be. I'm just gonna leave it at that one, and I'm gonna make this one something else. So I took out the idea of her drinking, and then I'm like, I want this to be super simple, super plain, but yet still have a little bit of that impact. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to get those bubbles to fade in. And I had two ideas as to how I wanted them to fade in. I thought either I could do just one whole block of it fading in as she drinks, or I could do one bubble, then the next, and then the next, and then the next. And it was more like, how much work do I want to put into that? And then I eventually decided, know what? I'm gonna do block by block by block, because that's gonna be easier. And so that's why you're going to see me edit one big, you're gonna see me edit one big chunk and have the bubbles there, and then I'm gonna get rid of the bubbles on a separate board. So here's the bubbles, and then the other's gonna lose it, and then I'm just gonna animate the bubbles fading into the shot. And that's the idea that I went for. So now I'm getting rid of it, making it look nice, blending it in. Pretty easy task overall. Looks good even just like that, and yeah. So I believe the next thing that I decide to do is I'm going to cut out the entire city. And the moment I realized that, I was like, oh, I need to get rid of the lampposts. That's not going to be too fun. So I forget what I'm doing right here, because you can clearly see. What was I doing? I don't know. I think it might have been my music. But yeah, these lampposts. Oh, they were tiring. They weren't the most tiring thing. I figured I found something more tiring than that later. But just cutting them out, and in all truth, that is the most tiring part about this entire project. It wasn't the animating. It wasn't the, it wasn't getting it to look right. The most tiring thing for me was cutting out the assets. And that's just because asset cutting takes so much time. Yeah, the animation part itself for me took 2 days, but it was able to be broken up between 2 days. I did like 4 hours one day, 4 hours another. The asset cutting was just a full straight 12 hours of me just cutting out asset, cutting out asset, cutting out asset. And at some point it's just like, I'm tired of cutting out assets. But yeah, when you don't necessarily have an artist and you don't have good art skills, kind of make your own assets, and that takes time. That's one thing I respect for anyone who animates using their own assets. It's just making assets is time consuming, and that's a lot of what this really is. I enjoy doing it, but it's time consuming, and the longer a project goes on, the more you're just like, oh, I don't want to do this anymore. And I fought that a lot when working on this project, because it was just, it's so much work. Like, when I was doing this, I was like, yeah, and you know what else I'm gonna do? I'm gonna have all the billboards be animated, and I'm gonna have the background flash different lights, and maybe I'll have stars go through the sky. And then the more I'm cutting it out, I'm like, I'm not doing half of that. I know that. And then even more so as I go into the animation, it's like, I don't want to animate all of this anymore. This is a lot. And yeah, it's something funny. It's like, you don't really realize how much work it is until you start doing the work. And yeah, it's just, it's a lot. And I have major respect for anybody who can just sit down and do this straight, because this is something you really need breaks for, because just looking at the same thing over time is just, oh, do I really need to? And yeah, so again, you see me trying to keep the shapes here. Eventually, I'm not sure if we'll get it. I think it's a bit of time before we'll get to the complicated part, where it was just, not only did I need to cut around, but then I also needed to cut these small itty bitty squares in the middle of it. You're gonna get a sample of it with that water tower or display screen. Just give me a second and you'll see me zoom into it, and it's gonna be a lot. So here you see me cutting out the middle background piece and just getting it to just popping out again. I had the idea of making the background lights look different, like the screens were changing. If at a later date I feel the inspiration to do it, I still have the files that allow me to go in and do that, so it's an option that's still there. I just don't think I'll end up doing it. I think this was probably the most intricate piece of the background because there were so many little holes. So like here with the satellite dish, there's those little gaps in between that I took out. Yeah, if I knew I wasn't gonna do the background colors, I probably wouldn't have done that. But, and what's done is done. Yeah, so again, more of those intricate pieces. At some point, it just became rhythmic to me. I think it was like by the third one, where it's just like, yeah, I just cut this, and I 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 cut this. But yeah, it's these little intricate bits that just started driving me crazy. So you're probably seeing this and you're probably wondering what I'm doing. I essentially forgot how I'm supposed to make the cuts. And realize I'm clicking something wrong. I forget when I figure it out, but it took me a couple of tries to figure out. And then I think what I ended up needing to do was, since I couldn't figure out how it worked, I went in individually and recut the little bits out. Mildly upsetting, but wasn't crazy, just annoying. So what I'm actually editing here isn't the city, but rather the sky in the background. And again, me thinking that I could do a lighting thing, which never comes to be, but that's kind of a lot of what the asset thing, like a lot of that half, the second part of this asset building thing was me getting them ready for this giant, this nice little subtle touch that I was gonna add and ended up not doing. And the more that I look at this, the more I feel I should go back and do the lighting thing. It's slowly persuading on me. So here you just see me building up the sky, bringing it down a little bit. I kind of made the sky a bit bigger than what I actually needed it to be. It looks a little strange, but not too terrible. It ends up looking a little bit more cloudy, I guess. So here you see me starting to animate, and I'm gonna set up the red section first. However, my first animation actually starts in the blue section, and that's mainly because with the blue section I can determine how much wind I want and how frequently I want, and then I could just have it be mimicked in the red section instead of trying everything to mimic the red, which is only one character who's going to be animated. Meanwhile, the blue's like 8 sections, so I decided, okay, I'll set up the red and I'm going to do the blue first. That way it's a lot easier to set up the red. So again, here's the blue section and me just setting it up. That way I make it a lot easier to set the red. And a lot of it is just me resizing, getting things into their proper places, at least for this section. If you want to skip me just placing things in order, go ahead about 4, maybe 5 minutes, and you'll see me when I actually start animating instead of just setting things up. So here I believe I start deciding what I'm going to animate first, and what I decide to start working on is the glasses. So again, here you see me just trying to get that nice little glasses tilt down just right so that it looks natural. And I do that by messing around with the rotation as well as the positioning. And then I do just a little bit of scaling difference, making it slightly larger as it does come forward instead of just going backwards, so it's not going to be getting smaller. I try to smooth it out a little bit, that way it looks more natural rather than just a robot going zip. Which is a lot of what you're going to see right there. And then the inverse, that way it goes back to its right place. Once I like what I see, I just copy and paste. And I think I ended up deciding on making it just a little bit longer in the next sections. So here you see me just planning out how I want to edit the hair, gonna puppet warp it and get those pins in. Then the main trick is to get the hair to flow naturally as if it were in the wind. So I take a look at what I'm looking at, how to organize it, and then I decide when do I want the wind to start moving. Once I've decided when I want the wind to start moving, how do I want it to move? Do I want a big dramatic movement, or do I want something small and simple? And then since this was also going to be the first part of the hair in total that moves, it's sort of the one that's going to dictate how I want the rest of it to go. Again, me just adjusting how fast do I want to move, and then I believe I realized I didn't cover enough the background, so I have to readjust it just so that I cover that little bit. That way you don't see the background popping out. But I think I decide to do that once I get the right speed done. Because as it stood right there, it was a little bit too fast for me. So I want to slow it down just a little bit. Get it looking just right. Here you see me just covering it up. I take a look to see how that looks. If I like it, I keep it, and then I copy and paste. So with the second piece of the hair, it became a little bit easier because I could follow the motions and the positionings of the first hair animated piece, so I just tried to mimic that in a certain way that made it look natural, but also as if the wind was also blowing that piece as well. It was a little bit of an easier piece, I'll say that. So here I toyed around with, do I want the ear to match up exactly with the wind? Because at first I thought it looked a little wonky. So I think I tweaked it just a bit so that it looks a little bit different. But it ends up mimicking the hair just about the same, if not exactly the same. And I think it does come out to exactly the same. Overall, I kind of like it. And I struggle to find words a lot of the time in order to sort of talk about what I do, and as much talking as I do, it's not something that I'm very good at. If I get better at it, you'll be able to tell, but it's something that I do want to work on, and something I think the channel might help me with, because I'll be talking about things that I personally like. It's not just I go here and I talk about it. It's me talking about things that I like, and I think that might help me a bit better than just, you know, what I already do. So I think this is the bubble animation. I think that's what I'm doing here now. Yeah. So remember when I said I could do the whole fade in, and this is when I was like, no, I'm gonna do the chop blocks. And the way how I did that was each bubble or group of bubbles would have its own mask, and then that mask would fade in and out. And that was something that I actually kind of liked doing. It was really simple, really easy. Really hope that I made those assets the way that they were. Now here I just fill around with when to fade them in and when to fade them out. And I wanted it to last long enough that it felt like it was sort of the character drinking it, and that tells you how much of the can they drank. So again, a little bit playing off that whole character's gonna drink the Coke, and then playing off of that, but not animating the character. So here I'm just messing around with the timing, making sure that it looks good. The first time when I did it, it was a little bit fast, especially with all of them showing up on the screen. So then I toy with messing around with the timing and when to put them. And then here's me making it stretch out a little bit longer. And me just, yeah, it's a lot of me just messing around with things. And I believe at this point I remembered I needed to fade them out as well, so that was more just me messing around with the timing between them all. So this is where I start working on the dreaded cheetah. So I'm adjusting the anchor points and getting it ready for rotation. The rotation part wasn't the hardest. It was sort of getting everything to match up with one another. So what I'm essentially doing here is a sped up walk cycle. And if any one of you have ever had to animate a walk cycle, you know how annoying that is. It's not necessarily hard, it's just tedious and annoying. And so what I wanted to do was a slow startup run into a full sprint, I guess, and then slow down from there. And this point is just me figuring out how fast do I want the first movement to be, and then slowly speed up from there. So then the next swing is almost the same exact thing, just closer together. And same thing with the third, I believe? Or no, the third I started out that way, but then I was like, no, at this point it should be fast enough where I could just do a full swing back without needing to slow down the rotation, so. And also I noticed how it looked a little bit choppy at this point, and I thought, would an easy's fix that? I forget when at what point do I try that, and just the easy's doesn't help at all. So I skipped out on that. So now with the back arm, it would be a lot simpler because I have the framework for the front arm. I kind of just need to mirror it, except in the inverse. So here you see the arms moving, and at first I thought it looked okay, but I wanted to test out that easy ease, and you're gonna see what happens with the easy ease that makes me say, yeah, no, that's not it. Because I believe the easy ease actually made it more choppy than it did make it look smooth. Let's see if I end up doing it here. I should have already tried it. Yeah, there you go. So there the easy ease looks pretty choppy. And so I decide against it, and instead I just keep it as is. I forget what exactly I was doing here. I think something was acting up. Yeah, and that happened a couple of times when I was working on this. The program itself ended up acting up, so I ended up needing to close it down and then reopen it just to make sure things were okay. It didn't happen too much with this project, but it was something that did come up every now and then. So a funny thing with the leg movement is that I believe it was like halfway through I realized, oh, I need to do a back leg as well. So I try copying the first leg, and that doesn't necessarily work, so I need to retime the leg after I finish copying it. So here you're going to see me working on the welcome in board, and it's pretty straightforward. I just need to find a good starting point that I can match with the ending, and a good ending point that I can match with the start. That way it looks like a loop, but in reality it's just the two pieces moving on top of each other. So another little trick that I'm working on here is I'm trying to get the, I'm using a solid layer in order to make a mask so that what you see is only the screen and you don't have the entire image in the background showing up. So here I was thinking about just doing sort of the fade in, fade out thing. I ended up deciding to make one completely invisible while it resets while the other's visible, and that ended up working out pretty well for me. So now you're gonna see me working on Shiro, I believe, and sort of the wind interacting with him. Since he's mostly a pretty rigid character, most of him does stay pretty pretty still. All that's going to end up being animated is his cloak, his tail, and I believe the top parts of his head. So what I'm basically determining is how much wind I'm going to put into the scene for both him and the Tanuki. So here I'm basically trying to mimic the front part of the coat with the back. Wasn't too hard, it was pretty easy, but I couldn't let it go so far. So essentially the back tail doesn't necessarily matter too much because a lot of it will be covered by the tail. But for the sake of keeping it even and for the little bits that do slip out under the tail, that's essentially what I'm doing. And you know, a lot of times with these projects, it is the little things that end up, it's the little things that make it look special. So something with the tail, I did want to mimic the coat, but I also wanted to give it that little bit of extra flair. Like, yes, it flows in the wind, but then he sort of whips it back into the shape that it normally is. I tried getting the whip to look right, but just it never feels right. I get it as close to how I feel it should be, but I don't know, some part of me just feels like it doesn't look right, but in the end, I did end up liking the way how it came out. So there's just me testing out how it looked, how it felt. Now you're gonna see me work on the little bits of the hair while this stays rigid. And while yes, it might be a little hard to see the tops of the hair, but for me, I think it helps. Helps sell the piece, you know? So now we get into the red section, and a lot of this is very similar. I have the times written down for when I did the wind movement on Shiro. So now for Tanuki, I kind of mirror that, and I think the biggest struggle I had was trying to keep all the parts that I didn't clean up hidden. Like here with her hair, I wanted to have this nice big swing, but then there's that little bit of unfinished that needs to stay hidden. So it was kind of just me working around that. So yeah, at first I did some rotation, and now there's a little bit of puppet warping to really sell it. You can make an argument that when you do one, you don't necessarily need the other, but to really sell that part, I think I needed it, so. So now with the back piece, I kind of just have to mirror what I did with the front. There's not much rotation here, even though I have it set up for that. I didn't really use it because I kind of moved it just a little bit too much more than what I wanted. So most of this is just puppet warping. So now with the tail, you see me, I really want to still, even though I'm not doing the full whole motion that I originally wanted to, I still want to have a lot of motion, sort of be an eye catcher when the wind blows. So for this one, I animate the entire tail, and in truth, I actually really like the way how it came out. I still would have liked to have done the bigger motion, but I like the way how the final product ended up looking. So there you go, that should be all the assets that I actually used in the animation. And I'm going to combine them all here, and the major thing with this one was just trying to fit it into place, and I ended up realizing I may have not put everything in the exact proportion and scale and positioning that they probably should have, but I work around that. It took me a little bit though to figure out how I want to fix it. I forget what exactly was going on here, but something just wasn't looking right in the final version. Or I think what I was trying to do actually is that I was trying to render at least the first part to make sure that all of it ended up looking right and there weren't any gaps. So that way in the main comp I have somewhat of a fully rendered comp to visualize and make sure that everything looks okay. This is me creating borders so that I can kind of cover up the edges a little bit, make it look a lot more natural. Sort of like that, you know, when you get the covers of a book, or maybe the movie box covers. That's kind of what I was aiming for with this. And so since I was deciding to do that, I also need the title of the show or the product. So that's going on to the side. That's just me arranging it correctly. So once I finish arranging it into its correct position, I give it a little bit of a glow effect. Something I thought about doing with the city, but in the end decided not to, so I guess you could call this my substitute for that. So I decided to glow the words a little bit. It's not drastic or to the degree that I thought it probably should have been, but I like the way how it finally came out. A lot of what you're seeing here is just me messing around and trying to get that glow just to look just right. And so now I'm putting into this little glow fade in, fade out, and once that is done, I duplicate it and sort of give it that mirrored effect. There's the mirroration, getting it to look just right. This is your final product. So thanks a lot for watching. If you enjoyed it, I would appreciate a subscribe and a like. And yeah, see you on the next project I work on.